Hey everyone, Nigel and Luke here, and welcome to the second part of our two-part series focusing on crimes that took place on Greyhound buses. If you haven't seen part one, be sure to check that out first. We'll leave a link in the description below. As always, don't forget to like and subscribe to Crime Zone for more true crime content like this. It really helps us to continue building the channel. With that out of the way, here is part two of two chilling crimes that happened on Greyhound buses. At approximately 12:30 a.m. on July 30th, 2008, Greyhound bus number 1170 pulled out of the depot in Edmonton, Alberta, and began its roughly 24-hour journey to the city of Winnipeg, Manitoba. Among the more than 30 passengers on board that morning was 22-year-old Tim McLean, a traveling carnival worker who was on his way home to see his family after the end of his summer employment. Tim had worked with the carnival for a few years, quickly discovering that he had a talent for talking to people and was promoted to running his own game booth. The lifestyle also fulfilled another of Tim's lifelong aspirations, his desire to travel. Growing up in the small farming community of Ely, Manitoba, he had always been an energetic and outgoing person, and with the carnival had been able to see all sorts of different places and meet different people. This trip home was supposed to be a special one for Tim, though. After spending some time in British Columbia, he had grown to love the province and decided to give up life on the road to move there permanently. During his time in Winnipeg that summer, he planned to formalize his living arrangements there. The first few hours of the trip that day were like any other. As a veteran rider of the Greyhound, Tim was used to long bus rides. They were his preferred method of transportation around the country, the affordable rates working well with the often inconsistent payouts from his work. In fact, he had chosen to travel by bus that day, even though friends had offered to purchase an airline ticket for him from Edmonton to Winnipeg. As the hours passed that July morning, Tim settled into his usual routine, grabbing a seat right near the back of the bus and slipping his headphones on to listen to some music. He got out at several of the scheduled stops for cigarette breaks and to chat with the other passengers, and also texted with friends saying that he was excited to be on his way home. At the same time that bus 1170 headed towards Manitoba, another man patiently waited along the route. His name was Vincent Lee, a 40-year-old Chinese-Canadian and former software engineer who had immigrated to the country in 2001. Lee had begun his journey 2 days earlier, also departing from Edmonton but buying a ticket to Thunder Bay, Ontario. Though he and Tim McLean should never have crossed paths, Lee had inexplicably gotten off his bus in the small community of Erickson, Manitoba, an action that would turn out to have tragic consequences. Though Lee did not bother anyone in Erickson, his presence in the town was immediately noticed when he got off his bus on the afternoon of July 29th. The driver told Lee that this was not his stop, but he did not seem to be bothered by this and exited the vehicle anyway. Approximately 6 feet tall and dressed in a black t-shirt and wearing sunglasses, he proceeded to sit on the bench next to the bus stop for most of the next 24 hours, waiting calmly for the once daily Greyhound that traveled through the town. During that time, he sold most of his possessions, including a nearly brand new laptop which he had said he wanted $600 for, but then gave to a local teenager for $60. The teenager would later say that nothing about Lee's demeanor seemed out of the ordinary. He was polite and calm, although maybe a little quiet. What no one could have known at that moment, however, was that Lee's mental state was nothing like his calm exterior. He suffered from schizophrenia, and while it's unclear whether this was diagnosed or undiagnosed prior to July of 2008, what we know for sure is that his mental illness had remained untreated for several years. Lee boarded bus 1170 as it arrived in Erickson that afternoon, just before 6 p.m. Though he initially took a seat near the front of the bus, after a stop in the city of Brandon, Lee moved to the back and sat down next to Tim McLean. Other passengers would later say that Lee moved through the row of seats looking around at people and seemed to sit down next to Tim after he gave him a small and polite acknowledgement. After that, Tim leaned against the window of the bus and fell asleep with his headphones on. Unbeknownst to Tim, over the next hour or so, Lee's behavior became increasingly unhinged aboard the bus. Few people noticed this, as by this point, the lighting had been dim for the evening. The vehicle was quiet, and most of those who were not too exhausted from the almost 18-hour journey by that point were watching the onboard movie. The exception was a 20-year-old man named Stephen Allison, who was sitting directly across the aisle from Lee and Tim. Allison witnessed Lee rocking back and forth, seemingly chanting some words or phrases that were not in English. Then, just before 8:30 p.m., when the bus was roughly 30 kilometers west of the small city of Portage-la-Prairie, everything spiraled out of control. Lee removed a large hunting knife from his backpack and, without a word, began to stab Tim McLean over and over again. Stephen Allison began to yell to alert the other passengers, and as the bus driver managed to pull the vehicle over to the side of the road, everyone desperately rushed for the exit. A couple of passengers who considered trying to take Lee down would later say that by the time they could intervene, Tim had already been stabbed between 50 and 60 times, and that there was nothing that anyone could have done for him. As the horrified passenger stood at the side of the road, Lee was left alone in the bus with Tim McLean's body. At that point, he began to behead Tim's remains. A truck driver named Chris Alguire, who had stopped after seeing the commotion, as well as another passenger, attempted to board the vehicle armed with a crowbar and a hammer, but Lee soon slashed through the door at them with his knife. They would later note how Lee seemed totally emotionless and almost robotic while he carried out the attack. After that, the door of the bus was barricaded until police could arrive. Though the RCMP soon made it to the terrifying scene, they made no attempt to board the bus. This was due to the fact that Tim was already dead, and police protocols apparently dictated that preventing any more deaths, Lee's included, was the priority. This would later become the subject of intense criticism, both from Tim's family and from the public, as the RCMP waited more than 4 hours before Lee was finally taken into custody when he attempted to break a window to escape from the bus. During that time, he further violated Tim's remains, consuming several pieces of his body. The shocking crime made headlines throughout Canada for days following the murder, and the grisly story soon made its way to an international audience as more details were released. Horrifyingly, because of the delay in identifying Tim's body, his parents found out about their son's murder from friends and from news reports before they could be contacted by police. Following Lee's arrest, he was charged with second-degree murder, but authorities quickly realized that there needed to be a serious examination done on his mental state. In his first court appearance just a few days after the murder, Lee repeatedly pleaded with the court to kill him. He was subsequently sent to a psychiatric facility where he was examined by Dr. Stanley Yaron to see if he was mentally fit to stand trial. Over the course of 19 visits, Yaron learned the serious extent of Lee's mental health issues. Lee explained to Yaron that he had repeatedly been told by God that people were trying to kill him, and that voices had warned him about evil people. He said that he had killed Tim McLean because God had told him to, and that he had dismembered his body because the voices had told him that the body would come back to life if he did not do so. Lee also said that everything was his fault, and that he was supposed to die after the killing was complete. These chilling details were further corroborated by some of the officers who had arrested Lee. When they took him into custody, he said that he was supposed to remain on the bus forever. Based on Yaron's thorough examination, it was eventually agreed that Lee would plead not criminally responsible to the second-degree murder charge, owing to his mental disorder. At Lee's trial in 2009, the presiding judge accepted his diagnosis and ruled that Lee was not criminally responsible for the killing. He was sent to the Selkirk Mental Health Center, a short drive from Winnipeg. The verdict was understandably controversial in Canada, as Tim McLean's family and many members of the public struggled to accept that Lee would serve his time in a mental health facility rather than a prison. In particular, Tim's parents were fearful and angered by the idea that Lee could one day be released from the facility. The backlash over the killing extended to Greyhound itself, with many people feeling that more should have been done to ensure passenger safety aboard their vehicles. The idea that Lee had been able to bring a deadly weapon onto the bus was a particular point of controversy. Making matters worse, Greyhound had recently launched an extensive cross-country ad campaign, the unfortunately timed slogan of which was, quote, "There's a reason you've never heard of bus rage." Greyhound announced that they were suspending the ad campaign a week after the grisly crime. Over the next few years, there were a series of updates released by the media about Lee's progress through the mental health care system, renewing the controversy and criticism around the case each time. In the summer of 2010, it was reported that Lee would be granted supervised walks around the mental health facility in an unfenced area. Less than a year later, in 2011, it was announced that Lee was responding well to his medication and treatment, and that he would slowly be given more freedoms that would be phased in over a period of years. This took place between 2011 and 2016, as Lee was first allowed supervised visits outside of the mental health facility that gradually progressed to being allowed to go out unaccompanied and to visit certain local areas. On February 10, 2017, the Manitoba Criminal Code Review Board ordered that Lee be given an absolute discharge from the facility, and that he have no further restrictions on his independent living. Lee reportedly changed his name to Will Baker, and no other notable information has been released about him since. As for the family of Tim McLean and the witnesses to the attack in July of 2008, many are understandably struggling to move on. Tim's parents have petitioned the government to change the way that mental health sentencing works in Canada, and also filed a $150,000 lawsuit against various people as well as Greyhound Canada. It is unclear what became of this lawsuit, however. The latest information we could find about it was from an article on the 10th anniversary of Tim's death in 2018, in which his parents said the proceedings were in limbo and that Greyhound refused to back down on anything. A previous lawsuit against the company for $3 million that was brought by two passengers on the bus was dropped in 2015, after Greyhound reportedly claimed that it could not be sued under Manitoba's no-fault vehicle insurance. Today, a roadside memorial still stands in the spot where the grisly crime took place that fateful summer night in 2008. A faded white cross is often surrounded by flowers and other items from friends and family who want the world to know that they haven't forgotten about the young and vibrant life that was taken from them far too soon. That brings us to the end of our list. Do you know of any other cases like this that you think we should check out? Tell us about them in the comments section below. As always, if you enjoyed our video, don't forget to like and subscribe to Crime Zone for more true crime content like this, making sure to hit the notification bell to stay up to date with our latest releases. Thank you for watching.